Frederick Aquino. I teach in the Graduate School of Theology. I teach philosophy and theology classes.
The topic tonight is very complicated. I mean, there are many ways to go at this. The problem of human suffering in the what appears to be seemingly God's silence. And one way to go at this is to think about it in terms of a formal philosophical account that tries to justify the existence of God in light of the preponderance of evil. So you think of the Holocaust, Crusades, or things like that, where it's clear evil is a reality. And then you try to figure out, how do you make sense of the appeal to the existence of God when you have things that seem to be counter that? So one way is to try to justify the existence of God in light of that problem. We're not going to be largely doing that tonight. We're not going to try to explain why bad things happen to good people. That's a conversation for a seminar in a philosophy class, and I invite you to take one if you'd like to have that conversation. But tonight, we're really going to look at the theme. The theme of the conference is loving God and your neighbor, right? So how do you love God and your neighbor while encountering people who may at times say, that sounds like a really good idea, but they're not able to do that for reasons largely related to a tragedy or a problem or a suffering or a dilemma in their lives? So we have two of my friends tonight, Darryl Tippens and Landon Saunders, who will be speaking to this from their particular point of view. And before we get into that, I'd like you both to say a little bit about yourselves, and then largely, what caused you to think about this issue? What, you know, what brought this issue up in your own life, or your own writings, your own speaking, and so on and so on?
Well, I'm here to hear Landon. Can we reel that in? Not a single person has said to me today, I hear you're doing something tonight at 8:30. Where are you going to be meeting? No, it's like, where's Landon? You know, I get that. Okay. I teach English here at ACU, and I also work in the provost office. I am a kind of advisor and a consultant, and I do projects for whatever the provost wants me to do. I also am trying to do some research and writing along the way, helping with Summit this week, it so happens. Before that, I was provost at Pepperdine University. My wife, Ann, is over here on my right, and our son, Kyle, is also a faculty member here at ACU, and it's a pleasure to be back in Abilene where our kids are. My whole life, as far back as I can remember, I've had questions. I remember as a small child, getting up late at night, all my siblings had gone to bed, and I'm lying in bed thinking, does God really exist? And I remember going in and talking to my parents when I'm maybe 5 or 6, I'm very young, and they basically gave me the cosmological argument right there, you know, there's the stars, there's this creation, if there's a creation, there has to be a creator, if there's a watch, there has to be a watchmaker. And I remember going to bed and thinking, I don't think so, maybe that's right, but I'm just not sure that cuts it, you know. So I've been on this journey my whole life wondering about the logic of creation and the explanations of suffering in the creation. And I'm still working on it.
There are a couple of things of interest in my own journey. As Darryl mentioned, I was exposed to all the sort of arguments for the existence of God. And I didn't have a very large sense of the world. And when I traveled in the world in 1969 and 70, looking at this creation that my faith said God loves, and it was very bewildering, encountering things sort of outside my own sphere of experience and understanding and sensing the world. And so after 7 or 8 months, I was in the East and Far East. And I entered what the mystics would call the dark night of the soul. And I lost everything. I lost all the foundations for my faith. I lost all of the views of God that I had held. I felt like a fraud. I felt like I had told others things that I didn't really know, things that had just, I'd been taught along traditional lines. And I resolved at that moment that I would make no pretense and would not make any effort to try to wire something back together. If God was, God would find me. And I continued to journey, and little by little, slowly, I found what I would start to describe as myself, my own life. And as I found my own life in a way that was more authentic, suddenly the idea of God was very beautiful and was very close. And I think I understood for the first time the expression in whom we live and move and have our being. And by getting rid of some of the idols of the mind about God, getting rid of some of those false images that created so many of the problems, one of which we're dealing with tonight, it created a space in my soul for thinking about God and the human condition in a little different way. It didn't solve everything. As was just said, I'm still working with the doubt side, and I find that I'd be scared if I ever lost that. I think it's essential to faith.
Well, let's start with that doubt. We all have experiences of doubt on some level. So one way to think about doubt is to see it as a negative thing, right? It's antithetical to the faith. It's contrary to being a believer. But I hear you saying that faith is not intrinsically negative. It actually has a positive, redemptive value to it. Why don't you say something about that?
Hold your mics closer.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Doubt. We're doubting.
Yeah.
But you're not Thomas.
Someone said that there are people who are totally certain, people who are uncertain, and people who are a little bit uncertain as they move. And I think that's where doubt comes in, that I'm very leery of anyone who is too certain about these issues. There's something about that that doesn't ring true, because there are things in this whole area that we cannot prove. We have to go to another experience. And in my own life with God, I moved, I think, from a rational attempt to understand God to trying to understand God through encounter. And that relieved a lot. But I think it's the doubt that keeps me thinking and praying.
Okay. Darryl, anything about doubt?
Doubt. A number of writers have helped me a lot, and one of them is Flannery O'Connor, in her stories, of course, but even more in her collection of letters. And if you don't know her collection called The Habit of Being, put it on your to-do list. Check it out at the library. Just wonderful letters that she writes to friends. She's a Christian. She's struggling with dealing with the real world. She says nihilism is the gas we breathe. It is the air, the atmosphere in which I work. And here is a person of deep faith operating in a space of profound questioning. And I brought a couple of her quotes. I thought they might come in handy. But one of the things she says is, I think there is no suffering greater than what is caused by the doubts of those who want to believe. I know what torment this is, but I can only see it in myself anyway, as the process by which faith is deepened. a faith that just accepts as is a child's faith and all right for children, but eventually you have to grow religiously as every other way, though some never do. What people don't realize is how much religion costs. They think faith is a big electric blanket, when of course it is the cross. It is much harder to believe than not to believe. If you feel you can't believe, you must at least do this. Keep an open mind. Keep it open towards faith. Keep wanting it, keep asking for it, and leave the rest to God. She says in a wonderful letter to a college student named Alfred Korn, heard her speak. She was on a speaking tour at college campuses, and I think he was at Emory University and was afraid to go up and actually talk to her. So he wrote her a letter and said, I'm an English major, and I'm losing my faith. And she writes this sweet letter to him. And we've published it in the anthology that I've edited because I think it's so powerful. And she says, you know, the prayer, Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief, is the most authentic prayer in the Bible. And she validates the crucible of doubt and shows again and again how a kind of authentic doubting, including learning to doubt your doubts. If you're going to be a skeptic, then go all the way and become skeptical even about your skepticism. It's a wonderful process that she lays out.
So if you were to put in one sentence a definition of doubt, because somebody might be listening to you and say, really all you're talking about is just a lack of faith. Is that what you mean by doubt? Or do you mean something more specific? And it sounds like, Landon, doubt comes in degrees. In other words, if you're Rene Descartes, doubt is fundamental to the idea of coming to know something. It has an instrumental value. In other words, if he can doubt anything, that it isn't a basis of knowing. When you think of doubt in the way that you're talking about it from your quotations and from your experiences, somebody said, give me a definition, what would you say? I mean, I heard faith, I heard uncertainty, maybe something like that, but is there anything else that comes to your mind in terms of a definition, especially in light of the problem of human suffering, right? Because that's the topic tonight. It's not just doubt in general. I mean, I can doubt there's an external world, I can doubt that I'm going to die, I can doubt a lot of things, technically, but tonight the doubt largely stems from how to come to grips with human tragedies, right? So any definition that might help someone along the way, without saying, I understand, we don't want to peg definitions because we're afraid that we might change, but if you're open to doubt, right, then changing is not a problem, right?
Well,
I just asked Darryl how he thought Flannery.
How was Flannery? I wish I could channel my inner Flannery here a little bit better. Well, let me switch authors. There's a wonderful Christian professor at Bethel University named Daniel Taylor, and he wrote a book several years ago called The Myth of Certainty. And one of the nicest things that happened to me in my years at ACU in the 90s was I had a group of students who clearly weren't going to church regularly, and I just invited them to come over to our home for a series of Wednesday nights, and we read Daniel Taylor's book together, The Myth of Certainty. And at the very core of Taylor's book, the point is that that if you're certain, then there is no room for faith. That uncertainty is wonderful because it creates space for the possibility of faith. In other words, if it's true that we walk by faith and not by sight, then to confess that you can't see, that's doubt, right? If you're walking in the dark and you're not sure whether there's a chair in the way, you're in a kind of epistemic doubt, aren't you? you're trusting. So there's a way to doubt simultaneously as you trust, as you walk in the dark. And isn't that really Barbara Brown Taylor's idea too, learning to walk in the dark? I highly recommend that book to you on this subject too, that learning to walk in the dark is actually being honest about the human condition, isn't it? It's admitting our finitude, it's admitting our existential limitations, and not pretending we're God. And so So to me, this kind of uncertainty is not scary, it's actually positive.
He used the word epistemic. I did not use that word tonight.
I withdraw that.
I've been accused of that on many occasions, but I did not use that tonight. And he used existential. Okay, we've talked about doubt, and it sounds like doubt might be, there's room for uncertainty. There's room for, because the very nature of faith allows for degrees of trust. And yet, because life throws us blows occasionally, it's hard sometimes not only to trust God, but to trust one another, right? So it sounds like doubt and trust are not necessarily enemies, but not having a full-blown notion of trust means that we're uncertain about what's going to happen. Are we going to be diagnosed in the next year? Are we going to lose a loved one? Are we going to struggle with certain questions? So it sounds like it's not harmful to have doubt in this sense, right? All right, let me flip it now. Because faith is getting a bad rap lately, right? People tend to think faith means having answers, having pat answers. And Darryl pretty much said that's not the operational definition, but that's not the definition you're operating with in terms of faith. So if doubt is relevant to faith and relevant to handling uncertainty and crises and struggle, what positive, not negative, what positive role does faith have in a time of crisis? You know, it's one thing to say, hey, doubt, right? And I know people, and some of them that are sitting in this room right now, they've lost people or they've had struggles, and silence was a really good antidote to the problem, right? They don't want to talk about faith. They don't want to talk about doubt. They just want to be left alone. But in the context of that, right, someone that you know, they're experiencing loss, they're grieving, what role does faith play? And if it does have a role, give an example where faith may actually be helpful rather than harmful to a person who has gone through a crisis or a problem. And you can fill in the blanks on what the crisis is.
It's your turn.
This whole question, of course, is about God. And I think that something that's worth considering is, if I am going to see God, where will I see God? And that's what has brought me to the belief that that the point at which God touches this earth in ways that are visible is in you. That the expression Christ in you, the expression that we will come and make our home in you, and if one receives me, they receive the Father. Here we're sitting before one of the most extraordinary things in the world, and that is the incredible power and value that is in a human life. Now, on the question of suffering, human lives, as we all know, go through it, but where I anchor my own faith is in the cry of the human that we call Jesus, who said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And there was silence. There was no answer. But it's helpful to remember that even in the cry, why have you forsaken me? It was preceded by the words, my God, my God. And so when I look for the place where we can get past all the argument, we get past all the rational deals, it really comes down to the theme of the summit, that somehow God is intricately connected with our neighbor and ourself. And if we would look harder at the human condition, then at least for me, some of my larger questions have been resolved. I don't know if that got anywhere near the question that you asked.
Yeah.
I'd like to share an insight I had from a Jewish friend who was in a seminar with me once, and he was from Massachusetts, Framingham, and he was telling me about his synagogue, and he was explaining that when a new person came into their community, a goy, I guess, someone who hadn't been raised Jewish, you could become a member of their synagogue, and they had a very simple question for you. And the question was, will you keep a Jewish home? He said, we don't have any theological tests. We don't have you answer a questionnaire, and then if you can pass the questionnaire, then you get to be a member of their synagogue. He said, because if you keep a Jewish home, then you're Jewish. And to me, that's a little bit more like the Old Testament, that faith is ultimately trusting behavior. And it's the person who acts out the way of life of a Jew, or in our case, a Christian, that we are in the way, then that is faithfulness. And so I think for me, moving away from abstract theological concepts and asking questions about practice gets to the heart of the matter. So a person who's in crisis, what they probably don't need is a series of abstract arguments about why your suffering is logical in the scheme of things. If you're in deep, deep anguish, if you are in desolation, if your soul is being decimated, you probably need presence, a human being there modeling the walk rather than really good arguments. And then one other thing, years ago I heard a philosopher say on the problem of evil that there are two kinds of knowing. She said, there is daytime knowing and there is nighttime knowing. And the problem with so many Christians is they want to give daytime answers to people who are in the night. And when I heard that, I immediately thought of C.S. Lewis's two books on suffering, The Problem of Pain and A Grief Observed. And they're profoundly different books because one gives daytime answers and the other is written in the night. And one will do you some good when you're in the night, and the other, I would never hand a copy of The Problem of Pain to someone who is in deep grief or in deep pain. Emily Dickinson says, but what about the drop of anguish that scalds me now? Don't tell me about how that in the fair schoolroom of the sky, this will all make sense someday. In the sweet by and by, it'll all be explained. She says, but what about the drop of anguish that scalds me now? I mean, if I'm in that level of pain, rational explanations actually have a counter effect. One of my friends once was going through a divorce, and he was in terrible misery. And he went to an elder of the church and wanting help. He was desperate. He was sinking. And the elder said, go home and pray and read three chapters of your Bible every day. Guess how helpful that was. That was a daytime answer for someone who was in the night.
Okay, so I think it's pretty clear that there's a wisdom in knowing how to respond to people based on circumstances that are largely out of their control, right? I mean, we don't ask for problems. Sometimes they come our way for various reasons. And it sounds like what you're saying is giving a rational account may not be always the most appropriate thing to do in circumstances. I guess the question is to, at least when I teach my philosophy classes, so a lot of undergrads who lose their faith precisely because they don't think you can talk rationally about faith, that there aren't any arguments, that it's all just hope and trust and faith being non-cognitive, not having any cognitive basis, right? It's just trusting something that you can't, in any sense, have any rational basis for. And so let me ask this. I get the relevance of not always giving formal arguments for the problem of evil. I get how that comes off to somebody in the evening, the dark night of the soul. But is there ever a place, I suppose, for reading someone like Richard Swinburne or like Ray, my friend from Notre Dame, who's written on this, Paul Moser, who's written on this, The Hiddenness of God. It's a big, big discussion now in philosophy. Is there ever, because I guess a worry I have is if somebody's hearing this, they might say, you know, at the end of the day, there's no basis for Christian faith other than just the, you know, work it out, hang out with people, eat with them. But at the end of the day, that's no different than any other sociological basis for being a part of community. So is there ever a relevant, again, I'm not being insensitive here, I hope, but is there ever a relevance for offering, not immediately, but at some point, somebody comes to you and they say, look, you know, I want you to think through, maybe you don't have the answers, but is there a place for people to engage this issue rationally, not just the alternative to being rational? Is there a place for that? I guess I wanted to ask that because a lot of students will ask me, is there any reason for believing in God? If not, then I'm gone. And then their parents call me or call someone else and want to know, you know, why did my daughter and my son not believe in God anymore? So is there a place for a rational discussion of this, or is this beyond the pale of rationality?
I want you to be employed. And so we need philosophers. We need people who can do the rational and the analytical thing, okay? Absolutely. I like to analyze poetry. But, you know, there's a difference between analyzing something and experiencing it. I guess I'm wanting both and, not either or. And it saddened me at times when I have taken a powerful sonnet into class that, just as Emily Dickinson says, you know it's a poem when it takes the top of your head off. And it's doing that for me. But once I finished properly analyzing the poem, the students are going, oh yeah, thanks a lot, and they're bored, okay? They did not have the experience of the poem in the way that I wanted them to. It seems to me that life is so rich, so complex, so mysterious, that it can never be completely reduced to rational analysis. That doesn't mean we don't do rational analysis. Another analogy for me would be medicine. I want my doctor to understand the science behind the medicine he's given me. I might not be able to understand it at all. I want the pill to work, but he may understand how the pill works. So it seems to me we want both. So be the scientist of metaphysics, as it were, and teach our students to get it right, you know, and understand it, but to limit the assumptions about what it can do in the world, on the ground, in a given place and time. Maybe handing someone a syllogism will save their soul at some point, but maybe another time it's a pat on the back instead. But it's both and for me.
Landon? Yeah, the times have shifted so that it makes this whole question different. I mean, in talking to millennials from coast to coast, not a single one of them ever raised the question about suffering and faith. And this, if we were back a few years, we would encounter this. But it's odd that they speak of God as their closest friend, and they think about God not in terms of rational argument, but almost epiphanally, that God said this to me, God said that to me. And so I think that as the world, as particularly the Western world, has moved from enchantment to disenchantment, that it has put these questions in a new context. And so we are responding to the question of human suffering when we are surrounded now with so much medical technology that has reduced so much of the suffering that human beings experienced medically a few years ago. And so I think that the changes that are occurring in the world are having profound impact on how we think about religious questions.
Okay. One last question that might be helpful. What are some concrete, practical ways in which we can love God and neighbor in the midst of human suffering, from your own experience? I'll start out. I'm supposed to be the host, but I'll add one. I've had friends that have gone through various problems, and one of my first things to do is to simply be there for the person, insofar as I am not going to orchestrate how the evening goes, or the day goes, or the moment goes, or the hour goes. I'm simply going to listen. And we didn't talk that much about silence, but I wonder if there is not just a negative, but a positive view of silence. That silence helps people to actually tune into, not just verbally but non-verbally, what's going on in their own minds. I mean, try doing this for 5 minutes. You know, just sit here, a Jesuit exercise for 5 minutes. Don't move, don't talk. And, you know, the things that come to mind, all the distractions. And so for me, concretely, one thing to do is to allow for silence to have not necessarily a redemptive value, but simply respecting the dignity and the integrity of the other person, not as a means to your own religious end, but simply as an intrinsic end that has, that person has value, and you're not going to manipulate how and why and when they say or think how and why they think. So for me, concretely, that's maybe one exercise to think about when you're encountering someone in the midst of suffering. And I never say, I know what it's like, I know what you're going through, because I don't. I don't know what it's like to be that person. I really don't. I'm not even sure I know what it means to be myself, let alone another person. So concretely, what are some other suggestions you might offer to people?
I'd like to say a couple of things. One is, I think the church, those who claim to be Christians, could do a lot better at being authentically who they really are, telling the truth about the story of their lives, telling the truth about what it really means to be human, telling the truth about even their doubts. And we could begin, for example, by actually worshiping with the Psalms. What we've done is we have sanitized the Psalms, and we have highly selected the Psalms so that they are not embarrassing to us, so that they are prettified, so that they are sort of safe. It disturbs me profoundly that I don't know of a single church where people sing the dark Psalms in a minor key. Where are the lament Psalms in our faith tradition? I don't think we have fully understood the damage we are doing to our Christian communities, and we're damaging the witness of the Christian communities by not telling the truth. And every time we worship and only tell half the story of what it means to be a Christian and not the other half the story, we are in effect being dishonest. And guess what? The inauthenticity speaks extraordinarily loud. And so one way we can get there is by restoring the Psalms to our worship, really. And by the way, the new hymnal that's being produced by AC Press has the Lament Psalms in there for the church to sing again, which we have not sung in my lifetime. If they've sung and been sung in your lifetime, talk to me after we break. The other thing we can do is restore the arts that tell the truth about it, what it's like to be Christians, really. And so we will read artists like Dostoevsky, you know, or Barbara Brown Taylor, for that matter. Or tomorrow we're going to be talking about Shusaku Endo, whose novel Silence tells the truth about real believers who are in real pain and who are real suffering, really suffering. And the amazing thing is, when Shusaku Endo does that, and he's a Christian in Japan, where fewer than 1% of the population are Christians, guess what? He gets a hearing. The Japanese people revere Endo. So here you have these Buddhists or Shinto or non-believers who can hear the gospel from a Christian because he's telling the truth through the arts. I think the isolation of the arts from our faith community and the isolation of the Psalms from the faith community has greatly damaged our ability to be believers.
Landon?
You know, I don't think I can add to that. I couldn't agree more, so I'm just going to say amen.
Well, I hope that you have learned some things tonight. And one of the closing remarks I want to make is something that Darryl said when I asked the question about the place of being rational. Is I'll give my chances. You had a homily. I'm going to end with a okay. with a. It's been my experience as an academic going to church. Sometimes we tend to go from one extreme to another. So it used to be we argued with people to get them into the faith, right? I remember that, the debating tradition. Sure. And now we've sort of over-responded to that by saying, you know, mystery and we can't wrap it up. But I don't know anyone that thinks being rational means you're going to have it all figured out. It just means you're going to try to make sense of it. So I'm hoping as a church tradition, we can allow for faith, darkness, rationality to all be at the table rather than say it's one or the other. And that's part of the Christian tradition. You've got Kierkegaard, he says, I believe because it's absurd. You've got John Locke, who doesn't say that. And I think we should learn from the host of witnesses that there's a place and a time for uncertainty and darkness, dark night of the soul. And there's a time for us to say something rationally as much as that's possible while acknowledging mystery as a reality. One of my philosophers said, I want to try to make sense of the faith, and if God says that's not right, I'll admit it. But there's nothing wrong with trying to make sense of your faith as much as that's possible while in the midst of uncertainty and darkness and doubt and suffering to maybe even just barely lift your hands to say, I don't get it. Right? Honesty is a good thing, but I guess I'm hoping, going to church and listening to the hymns and the homilies, sometimes I think we're embarrassed by our past. We're embarrassed by being rational or trying to be rational. And I want to say there's nothing wrong with being rational until it becomes inhumane, right? Until you say something that's just thoughtless when somebody's suffering. So I guess my parting word is, as we go through this issue, let us allow for diversity of expression, diversity of experience, and not try to wrap it all up into one experience or one personality trait or one disposition. So I want to say to my two friends here tonight, I appreciate their willingness to do this because they did come on faith tonight. We had very little conversation about how this was going to go, and I would say please give them an applause.